Hello, friends. This is Rebeckah Vernon coming at you with my second sermon. Today, I want to talk to you about the secret to being happy. Not necessarily all the time. Life has trials, but a lot of times we find ourselves in a sad place in life where we're crying out to God, "Why am I so miserable? Why is everything so terrible?" And a lot of times we want to blame God. And I am here to tell you that maybe we should be blaming ourselves. And that's a hard pill to swallow. I guess you could call this sermon why I thought being happy was more important than being gay. So, before you throw stones, hear me out, grab your Bible, and let's go over this. Okay, hi everybody, thanks for joining me. Today I want to talk to you about something very serious. It's a very heated subject, and I think more than a lot of people, I have a right to talk about this because I was there, and I was living in this lifestyle. So one day I realized that being happy was better than being gay, being homosexual. And hear me out, and don't go throwing stones. What I have to say could actually change your life. So, God's word is full of laws, and some people say that these laws are meant to control us, and I say that these laws are actually kind of like a recipe or a secret map that can lead you to a healthier and happier life. But more importantly, these laws can ensure that you inherit the kingdom of heaven. One day I was... Let me clarify. We are saved by grace, by our faith in Jesus Christ. But there are some specific mentionings in the Bible that we are going to go over, if you will bear with me. So, one day, I was sitting on the couch, crying my eyes out, wishing I could die, and unable to count how many times I had found myself in this broken state before. So miserable, I just couldn't bear to go on. And I threw my hands up, and I threw my head back, and I cried out to God, "Why is it always like this? Why do I always wind up feeling so miserable?" And I wasn't expecting an answer that day, and the answer I got really actually surprised me. I can't even explain to you in complete detail the full answer, because in order for you to actually understand, you would have had to have lived my life every day with me. But the summary that I can share with you is basically this. God said, "All those times I comforted you when you were just a child with visions of a future, a better, brighter future, how did they compare to the life you are living now?" I was stunned because basically God was showing me that He had planned this wonderful life for me, but I was pretty much screwing it up with my own choices. So, and my own free will. The biggest blaring mistake that I could see right at that moment in my life was my choice to live as a homosexual. And I do want to point out, a lot of people want to argue that it is not a choice. It may not be a choice that you are confronted with feelings of being a homosexual, but you do inevitably choose to live that lifestyle. So for me, the biggest mistake I could see causing my unhappiness in that moment in my life was my choice to live that lifestyle. And I decided that day that I would no longer be in any homosexual relationships. I would no longer have relationships with women and would remain single and celibate for the rest of my life if I had to. For me, it was more than a fair trade for a chance of a life that God had shown me, a happy life. All of those times that He had sent His comforting spirit to me as a child growing up when I was really sad, you know, growing up abused, a comforting spirit of God had come to me and shown me promises of a better tomorrow. As I wrote this sermon, it was at first about the sin of sexual immorality, and I realized that it was really, in truth, about so much more than that. You see, God's word basically lays down a list of things called sins of the flesh, which are part of his promise, which are not part of his promise, which are basically conditioned upon his promise of a better life. He has planned for those who deny the desires of the flesh and instead walk in the spirit. So next time you are sad and depressed, wondering how much more life or God is going to throw your way, take a look at yourself. What you're doing and how you're living your life before you blame God for your troubles. Take a personal inventory. I want to go over some scripture with you now, which covers exactly what behaviors and acts are not only standing in the way of so many people and their happiness, not just gay people, not just the unsaved people, but Christians too. These are things that are standing in the way of your happiness, and also endangering your inheritance to the kingdom of heaven. I want to remind you as we go over these scriptures to really open your mind. Okay, I don't want you to see these as a list of oppressive rules, or, you know, regulations you have to live by. I really just want you to see this as a formula for uncovering a hidden treasure, a secret that nobody told you about, okay? That's how I want you to just open your mind and see this as something totally new, as if you've never heard it before, okay? And go with me now. We're going to look at Galatians 5, chapter 16 first, okay? And I'm going to go in the Strong's Concordance too. If you don't have one, that's okay. Just take note and look it up online later. It's totally free. We're going to go to Galatians 5:16. It says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh." We're at war with ourselves, right? "And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law." Freedom! Okay. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Adultery. You know what? If ye can grab a pen and paper, write this down. Make a list of the things which are making you unhappy in life. And this way you can just eliminate them today and you're on your way to a brighter future. Okay. Galatians 5:19. "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness," and we'll go over the meaning of some of these, by the way, "idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envying, murders, drunkenness, revellings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." Okay, uncleanness, this means like physically or morally, and believe it or not, it also means demonic, okay? A lot of pastors and preachers don't really want to preach on this or talk to you about it in church, but demons are real. And Christ has given us the authority to cast them out. And in your Strong's G169 uncleanness, you can see right here. There you go. Demonic. All right. So uncleanness also means demonic. Lasciviousness is, it's basically lewd or hypersexuality or wantonness, which is immodesty or promiscuity. So basically you're fast and loose, getting around town, witchcraft, that seems pretty self-explanatory. But aside from magic, spells, and sorcery, this also includes potions. And the Strong's Concordance number for this is G5332. If you want to look in more to that. Okay. Variance. Hatred, I'm going to leave alone because that one's kind of self-explanatory. But variance is in the same family with hatred. And it includes quarrelsome debates, malice, contention, and strife. And emulations. This means to be hot with jealousy, envy, or zeal, as with a husband or enemy. So husbands and wives, or boyfriends and girlfriends. If you're like always jealous because that person's looking at your wife, or who are they talking to, and what are they doing online, that's not good for you. That's only going to make you unhappy in the long run. Wrath. This is a fierceness or indignation, specifically mentioned as breathing hard, breath, that is by inclination, that is wrath. Important note, this is a spirit and is an animalistic spirit. Again, demons and spirits are real, and these are to be rebuked and cast out. Strong's G5590. There you have it. For those of you who have not watched my videos, I am not holding these up long enough for you to read them. Just so you know, I'm not making them up. And please look into it later. Don't take my word for it. Always, always, always read God's word for yourself. Don't trust the word of man. All right. Strife. Strife is intrigue or prolonged or stimulated anger. So prolonged anger over something, if you just boil over something and let it simmer, or it's stimulated anger. So like if you get mad about something and 2 weeks later you remember it and you're just as mad as you were 2 weeks later, that is strife. Strife. Now, seditious. This comes from a word meaning disunion, division, double-mindedness, uprising, or uproar. So the Strong's for that is G4714, and you can look that up for yourself. Isn't it great to know that, you know, we live in this modern era where they've already done basically all of our homework for us, and you don't have to rely on man telling you this is what they meant when they wrote it. You can actually look at the definition of the original word that was written in the Bible. That's great. Heresies. These are when one takes what they like and leave the rest, basically borrowing from an idea or theology and only the parts which suit you. So that would be like me taking the law of gravity and only taking parts of the law of gravity which I like and leaving out all of the other parts of the law of gravity. It would no longer really be the law of gravity. It would be a heresy of the law of gravity. And that one is G138. That is where I derived my definition of heresies. All right. Drunkenness, I feel the need to point this out for you guys. This likewise includes all forms of intoxication. That's important to point out in this day and age because, you know, we are like our Father God. We are also creators, and we have created more ways to intoxicate ourselves over the ages. Revelling. Or reveling, that was a typo on my part. Reveling is to be laid up, carousing, or rioting. And that comes from a word meaning comos, G2970. And that can be found in Strong's as well. All right. Now I want to go to Ephesians 5, verse 3. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Neither filthiness or foolish talking or jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. Basically, and I didn't bother to pull this up on Strong. I mean, I did. I looked it up. I didn't take photos. But jesting and foolish talking is basically lewd speech or crude language, so dirty jokes and foul language. For this ye know, that no whoremonger or unclean person nor covetous man who is an idolater hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. There are a lot of people that are going to tell you, it's okay. God forgives. He loves you anyway. Yes, he does love you. And yes, he does forgive. But you know what? He is a God of wrath. And he has basically told you, this is what I want of my children. There are consequences for your actions. You are forgiven and you are saved by faith in grace, but the wages of sin are death, and if this, then that. I mean, it is not that complicated. I'm going to read that again in Ephesians 5:6. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Ye not altogether with the fornicators of the world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or with idolaters. For then must ye needs go out of the world. Okay, but now I have written unto you not to keep company of any man that is called a brother, be a fornicator, or covetous, or an idolater, or a railer, or drunkard, or extortioner, with such as one, no, not to eat. For what have I to do to judge them also that are without? Do not ye judge them that are within, but them that are without God judgeth. Therefore put away from among yourselves that wicked person. Remember that saying like your parents used to tell you, that you are who you hang with? It came from somewhere. What is a fornicator anyway? Let's talk about that. Okay, a fornicator, according to Strong's, is someone who basically sells themselves. It says a male prostitute, by analogy, a debauchee, a libertine, or a whoremonger. And let's get that in focus, kind of. Can you see it? I don't know. Yeah, there you go. Now you got the number. You can look it up. But I want to point out what it says in Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ Jesus. So men are not the only fornicators here. We're not pushing this off on the men. Women are fornicators too, okay? Okay, so now that we know fornicator is a prostitute, what is a covetous person? A covetous person, oh, and I want to point out, by the way, the Greek for fornicator is pornos. Pornos. Funny, huh? Okay. Maybe not. I thought it was. Okay, covetous person. Desiring more, that is eager for gain, avaricious, or a defrauder. What is an idolater? That is someone who worships or is a worshiper of images, literally or figuratively. Do you watch too much TV? Do you spend more time with your television than you do with God? Do you even know, like, how crappy the stuff they offer us on television? That is a whole nother thing. But I just want to say, I used to watch a lot of television, a lot, and I have been television free for since May of 2014. So yeah, and I don't even need meetings for that. I have just so much free time to do all the things I want to do. You know, in fact, when they came out with DVR, I thought, Yay, I'm no longer a slave to the television. But guess what? I was now a slave to my DVR. Anyway, like I said, a whole other thing on that. But anyway, idolater is a servant or worshiper of an image, literally or figuratively. What is a railer? That stems from harpazo, which we also know means where they got the term rapture, but that means just to take or pull or pluck by force. So, yeah. That's also very similar to someone who is an extortioner. So let's look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11. Because I know you probably think that I'm being judgy, and I'm not, because I want you to remember, open mind. This is not about judging you. This is about opening you up to a way of life that is like a secret recipe to happiness, okay? So Hebrews 12, 11. Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Exercised of their demons, by the way. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Guess what? Yay! Healed, okay? All right, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Okay, looking diligently, lest any man fall out of grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Okay, lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know that afterwards, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. So, in Romans, there is a section, Romans 1:18, that talks about God's wrath upon unrighteousness. Now, everyone talks about how God's mean, but he really kind of warned us, you know, to avoid certain behaviors to avoid the wrath. So that was really nice of him, because not only did he warn us once, he warned us several times. Romans 1:18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God had showed it unto them. I forgot it said that too. See, scripture backs it up. Okay? For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Basically, that's saying even if you don't have the Bible or me to tell you this stuff, you can see by the trees and the stars and all of God's creation that there is a God. Okay? So you have no excuse. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Now listen up. Those of you who say being gay is not a choice, you're kind of right, because hear this. Who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, God gave them up into vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the women, burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to reprobate mind, to those things which are not convenient. It's not convenient to be gay. Anybody who is gay knows it's not convenient. You know, one of the things I told my niece, who decided to tell us all that she had had a girlfriend for a month, was, you know what? Be careful, because, you know, although a woman may know how to please you better than a man, she's more crazy. So right there in the Bible, prophetic, it says right there, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Okay. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, gay pride. I'm so glad I'm gay. So glad I face adversity left and right. I'm so glad that I put my orgasm above my personal relationships. Really? I'm so glad I don't give other people a chance because I'm more interested in getting off. Really? For those of you who aren't gay, I apologize for that. But seriously, I'm not saying you're incapable of loving because you're a homosexual. What I am saying is you put your lust and your flesh above your spirit. And that is wrong in the eyes of God. Sorry. I love you anyway. I've been where you are. Please stick with me, okay? Being filled with unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, and whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who, knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Who, knowing the judgment of God, they not only do, but have pleasure in them that do them. Wow. Who, knowing the judgment of God, they not only do, but have pleasure in them that do them. That is today, you guys. That is prophetic. Excuse me. 1 Corinthians 6:9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revellers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed. Ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. What does it mean to be effeminate or an abuser? Effeminate in the Strong's right here means finely dressed or soft. So the effeminate boys, you know, hey, or even straight men who are overly concerned with their clothing or appearances, or women as well, I suppose, because it says right here, of uncertain affinity, soft, that is, fine clothing, figuratively, academite, effeminate, and soft. And to be abusers of themselves with mankind, that is from this one in Strong's, if I can get that in focus. Meaning a sodomite, abuser that defiles itself with mankind, basically what it says. A lot of people say a sodomite is someone who engages in anal sex. That would go under the list of sexual immorality and lasciviousness. And that is not what sodomite means. A sodomite is a quasi-sacred person, technically a male devotee who is given to prostitution. The word sodomite used as someone who engages in anal sex did not come about until the 13th century. So, let's look at Acts chapter 15, and I encourage you, anyone who has been told that they are held under the law of Moses in order to achieve salvation, that is a lie and a fallacy. You are saved by grace, and I encourage you to read the entire chapter of Acts 15. But this is what Peter and all of the apostles said. But that ye write unto them that they abstain from pollutions of idols, from fornication, and from things strangled, and from blood. That's it. Okay? You are not supposed to obey the Sabbath on a certain day or eat certain foods or any of that stuff. That is what the Gentiles who are called to Jesus, right there, that's your list of things that you have to worry about. Not all 600 and some odd laws of Moses, okay? That is what was given to you, Acts 15:20, by the apostles to observe. Abstain from pollutions of idols, from fornications, and from things strangled, and from blood. Don't be deceived. Now let's look at Jude 1, 5, where it says, I will therefore put you in remembrance, though ye once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. And the angels, which kept their first estates, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under the darkness into the judgment of the great day. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Likewise also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but saith, the Lord rebuke thee. But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. They corrupt themselves. It's not God's fault. You're not sad because of God. God didn't make you unhappy. So now that you know what you're supposed to avoid, fornication, adultery, drunkenness, lasciviousness, murder, envy, covetousness, strife, you know, all of these things. I'm going to put the verses down there so that you can go back and look. Now you know what you're supposed to avoid. Again, not as like an oppressive law that is a recipe, a roadmap, secret success. What do you have to gain? What are you going to uncover? Not only can you be sure with your faith in Christ that you're going to inherit the kingdom of heaven, but your life will also bear witness to the fruits of the Spirit. Okay? But the fruit of the Spirit is you're going to have love. You're going to have joy. you're going to have peace, you're going to have long suffering, which means that, you know, those little things that used to bug you and come against you and go, why, God, why? They're not going to really bother you anymore. Gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Against such there is no law. Doesn't that sound nice? Love, joy, peace, and gentleness, and goodness, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. And if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. And then Ephesians 5:9 says, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, for proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. This is my reproval. But also more than my reproval, this is me telling you the secret of happiness. Am I all the way there yet? No way! But am I working on it? Yes, I am. And my very first step was deciding that being happy was more important than being gay. If that's you right now, I'm praying for you and I'm here for you and I will talk with you and I will counsel you. If you're having a problem with alcohol, my husband, he had the same problem. He can be there for you. Both of us had to walk away from the occult. If witchcraft is your problem, we can be there for you. Are you suffering with demons? We have experience with deliverance ministry. We are here for you. This is not just a video where we can go, hey, look at us, and talk to people on YouTube. This is a ministry. And we will pray for you. We will counsel you. We will give you an encouraging word. And we will lift you up. We love you very much. And we pray nothing but your blessing in Christ. And we will see you next time. God bless.